I'm going to sort of partly read out the paper, but it's going to be led by the slides visually. So there's essentially quite a large number of slides. So I'm going to just kind of read, but I'm going to have to pick out bits of the paper too in order to get it into the 30 minutes. So what I want to talk about is essentially the idea of the ephemeral as a sort of strategy of cultural critique in contemporary art in China. Following a recent investigation into the issue of culture and corruption in China with reference to the decline of traditional Nianhua in 21st century China, and this was a project I did which was trying to contrast the urban contemporary art scene with what's happened to traditional Chinese printmaking in the countryside in Hebei province. And the idea was that there's been a decline of the practice of traditional printmaking. And I was looking at a little museum in Hebei, a museum of Nianhua, of New Year prints. And what I discovered in this little museum was that it was trying to kind of show the history of Nianhua, but at the same time as it was doing that, it was sort of ignoring actual printmaking going on in that region in Hebei. So there's a kind of issue of decline at the same time as the Nianhua is being represented in this museum. And I just wanted to set the paper against this idea of sort of decline and renewal, and the essential idea of sort of artists activating through using sort of ephemerality within their work. Okay. So the paper attempts to explore ephemera within contemporary art practice from China as a powerful strategy of resistance to the commodification of culture through action, remembrance, and everyday objects. Various aspects of the ephemera will be considered within the cultural discourses of decline and renewal in modern China with reference to contemporary art and cultural practice. Some of the earliest artworks in China in the 80s, like contemporary art, relied on the ephemeral as an antidote to established notions within the acknowledged discourse of fine art following the establishment of the People's Republic in 1949. More recently, many artists incorporate the ephemeral into their work as a material or embodied source of activation. Even within the most recent large mainstream exhibitions, such as this year's 9th Shanghai Biennale, curated by Chiu Jiajie, this idea is at the center of the exhibition's curatorial concept. And this is essentially a sort of a huge sort of mapping with the idea of reactivation, which Chiu Jiajie, a conceptual artist who is based at the center of the China Academy in Hangzhou, to show you this idea of activation even within a mainstream exhibition such as the Biennale, the Shanghai Biennale. The forces of corruption in post-Dong China have wedged art into a compromised position between various power networks and vested interests. Cultural endurance, it could be argued, lies within the nature of art as praxis, in which art is enacted, practiced, embodied, or realized. What might be seen as ephemeral is in fact continual cultural activity, in which human agency and participation is its life force across time and space. This idea is reflected and critiqued in numerous artworks as an intrinsic resistance to cultural control and definition, encompassing the complex issue of consumption. By using examples of contemporary art, I'll explore the ephemeral in contemporary art as a form of cultural endurance that undermines the notion of culture as a commodity, but is also tied into the question of cultural and material consumption, which makes connections to a longer history of cultural practice in China. So in the reform period following the Cultural Revolution, many early occurrences of what might be called the autonomous art practice in the 1980s took place as short-lived events in the form of fluxus-style happenings and exhibitions. which were often shut down within hours of their being put up. And this work here is Wu Shanzhuan's Selling Pools, Big Business, which was shown in the avant-garde exhibition, the China avant-garde exhibition in 1989 in Beijing, in the National Gallery. And it was an exhibition that brought together a huge number of works which had been sort of accumulated over the previous sort of 5 years in China, with active groups working collectively all over China. And so this actually was one of the earliest sort of conceptual works, which was essentially a critique of art as a commodity, even you know, by the end of the 80s, pre the kind of big economic rise of China. There was this awareness, particularly the artist himself sort of said, you know, that selling had become part of art production. And this is kind of, it was barely kind of visible in China at the time. So it's quite interesting that he did this early. But it was closed down within hours. You know, he was subsequently sort of forced to remove the pools. So he bought something like 30 kilos of pools from a village in Zhejiang province and brought them into the gallery space. And then one of the people who bought them was the first buyer, was a kind of well-known sculptor. It's just, you know, the whole scene is a case of selling the pools. And so all of this stuff, there was a lot of this kind of activity going on, which was about really sort of placing the artist and the action against the institution within it, you know, using the institution as a sort of site. So in the 21st century, the Chinese art world has evolved into a highly active cultural sphere, yet art itself has become pushed into a commercial realm in which arguably monetary value supersedes cultural value. The paradoxical relationship between the outburst and proliferation of cultural activity, followed by a distinctly commodified treatment of culture, set down a pattern in which the value of cultural autonomy waned as the imperative remaining in the economics of culture developed, pushing out certain possibilities of working independently of such a system. I won't really go into more detail about that, but I think the main idea is that, you know, it may be that culture's always been commodified, and so one has to be careful to say that this was a moment of cultural autonomy. But the 80s, particularly in China, look back as a kind of mythological period of sort of freedom. And you know, a lot of curators are writing about that now in China, particularly Gao Minghu, who's one of the main writers on contemporary art. So you know, it sort of gains this sense that it's the only time that anyone was free to actually do culture on their own terms, autonomously. And yet, you know, that's questionable as to what extent we can really sustain that argument. Because in a way, it just shifts from moment to moment, and it becomes commodified in different ways. Much of art practice in the emergent art scene in China during the 80s worked with aspects of the ephemeral as a point of resistance and critique. The 85 movement, as it became known, came about through the accumulation of many artists working collectively to produce art events that were conceived as resistant and progressive cultural acts, pushing for the resistance against established art conventions, such as oil painting, and a limited political, social, and cultural environment that was developed for innovation. These kinds of activities drew their inspiration from Euro-American ideas of the avant-garde, following such movements as Dada and Fluxus, which is very relevant to the sort of backdrop of that kind of practice. But in a closer temporal and cultural reference, art groups in Japan since the 50s have also produced radical critique for society through the use of found objects, performance, and natural phenomena. You know, this would be people like the Gutai group from the 50s in Japan. So there were sort of quite a lot of references, and this is a collection of books, the type of books that were available to artists who were looking at both things like Chan Buddhism, Wittgenstein, you know, Sartre, a variety of different philosophy. But one of the things that's come out of some of the research, mainly by our Asian Art Archive in Hong Kong, has been the extent of reading that was done in the 80s by many, many artists. And there was a huge and avid hunger for reading texts after a period of, you know, relative sort of stagnation because of the Cultural Revolution and sort of predominance of politics. And move forward. So some of the early examples of sort of ephemeral action in art practice were things like the Stars Group, which were one of the first independent art groups who put works up on a fence in Beijing, a well-known event, in 1979. But, you know, one of the sort of aspects of using a sort of ephemeral or kind of short-lived events as art works in China is the sense that there is a kind of inbuilt or embedded collectivity built into cultural practice in China, which isn't entirely new and has been going on since the 50s, actually, within the communist period. So it's not, you know, it doesn't act suddenly as a kind of entirely new thing. But I'll try to move on to the Shamanbaba. So one of the artists who actively articulated this critique of culture in his work and writings was Huang Yongping. Huang developed his work after graduating from the Zhejiang Academy in 1982, beginning with a critique of modernism using surrealism, and then developing a Dadaist strategy. By the formation of Siam Dada, an art movement made a group of artists that took its name from the European Dada movement in Xiamen, a coastal city in southeast China, in Fujian province. The Xiamen Dada were a group of five artists, and they essentially scribbled on canvases so that the art itself was already deemed sort of ephemeral and had no value as soon as it was made. It has no sort of intention of becoming a fine artwork in the first place. And then it was sort of, you know, the actions, they were thrown onto a bonfire, and that was it. They burned the work. Because a chalk, you know, a circle of chalk was drawn around it, and it said, you know, Dada ends here, effectively. So it's got this sense of a sort of manifesto attached to it, and a kind of action, flux of scarf action. And I'll just go back to the music for a minute. So Siamen Dada's anti-art spectacle held as a sort of ritualistic ceremony to erase the privileged status of authorship and skill. And the issue of authorship is quite important because the, you know, many of the groups deliberately gave them names with no author attached. So it seems like the no name group, the five artist group. And so there's a deliberate idea of, you know, we're not going to kind of place the artist on a pedestal, which of course we've now come back to fully in the 21st century. So Huang Yongping says, you know, I read a lot during that period. Bookstores would constantly be changing the titles on their shelves. So one had to read really quickly before the next set of books would place the old books on the shelves. I could read really fast, but the information wouldn't always stick. I loved to read about philosophy, but philosophical texts took time to absorb, so I spent a lot of my free time focusing on these texts. I especially enjoyed reading Wittgenstein, and most of us artists would eagerly await new translations of books. When they were available, we would immediately devour them. So this sense of, again, we're going back to the issue of consumption, it's consumption of information, you know, in order to produce something new, and there's a kind of avid consumption of these texts, which is kind of relates to consumption of the object, what we're talking about in terms of kind of philosophical concept, the object. And then the sort of another kind of good example of an early exhibition in which found objects were used is this exhibition of five artists in 1986, which was held for the museum, the Fujian Art Museum. And he said, this is Huang Yongping again, we submitted a proposal to the Fujian Art Museum to present an exhibition. We wrote a proposal which we knew would have a high chance of being accepted, but we did not provide details about the real project we had in mind. abandoned our fake submission proposal and instead curated an exhibition of found, mostly random construction materials, primarily found in the museum surroundings. When the museum officials realised this was not what we had proposed to do, they shut down the exhibition. It was up for about 2 hours. So again, it's this temporal sort of, you know, moment of the ability to do something and then it's taken away. There's a sense of constant sort of dynamic of this going on. And a further example of these kind of ephemeral activities was the sort of what might be called performance, although actually they weren't seen as performance by the artists. Again, there was no such thing as sort of performance art as such. So this is kind of activities which are collected involve kind of movement, cloth, sort of choreographing of some sort, fairly rough, kind of quite contingent feel to it. And this is Shoji's with a group of artists, Concept 21, Great Wall, in 1986, which again is fairly typical at the time and gives you a sense of the mood and sort of atmosphere of the, you know, the sort of fluxus style going on. But I'm going to talk a little bit about this following year, which is also part of Concept 21. So a classic example of the moon environment in the 80s was Concept 21 Art Happening, a performance event held on 23rd of December 1986 at Beijing University. It was held as part of a cultural festival on Beijing University campus, which included lectures, talks, readings and films, and involved a number of artists, including Xi Zhenjun, Shen Qi, Rohan, Ju Qingsheng, Hong Tan, Fan Tian, Zheng Ke. But the point about that, when I'm reading, you know, Fan Tian is now the head of the National Gallery in Beijing. So you sort of read the names and you suddenly think, oh, right, he's like at the top of the Chinese art world now. You know. But there he was doing a performance in sort of minus 10 degrees in Beijing. So on a freezing cold day in December, the artists firstly stripped off up to their underwear, then used all sorts of lengths of black, red and white cloth and other things picked up from the ground and wrapped them around their bodies and exposed themselves to this sort of extreme weather. They went, this is kind of their wandering around Beijing University campus. They went upstairs and gained inspiration and inner strength from the enthusiastic sound of the beating of drums. And then Kan Wu and Zhao Jianhuanghai, whose bodies were painted in black and white to pursue a high-speed feeding of mines, got on their bicycles and cycled around the woods. Xi Zhenjun, who was wearing red pyjamas, after 28 minutes of silence, suddenly stripped off his clothes and appeared stark naked. The title derived from the popular saying, "We don't care if 3 times 7 equals 21, which means, you know, who gives a damn. So there's this kind of avant-garde sense, sort of illogical sort of. I mean, one is that it taps into the idea of the everyday, but also there was a kind of statement of them saying, we want to return art to the people. By Yishu Wei Guanren. And so, you know, it expressed the sort of spirit of this kind of activity. And that's the China Avant-Garde exhibition, where much of this kind of work came to be shown in 1989, preceding June 4th, and shown in February that year. And this work, the famous work by Xiao Lu, the female artist, was called Dialogue. And it culminated with, it was an installation of two telephone booths with a kind of telephone with a receiver hanging. These were sort of nominals like an installation. And she walked in and shot two bullets at the installation, culminating in her own arrest and closure of the exhibition shortly after its opening. so we go, go through that sort of theme of things being cut short and being deliberately ephemeral, kind of ephemeral, and kind of causing sort of intervention into the sort of conventions of the artwork of time existing. So in many of these early works that act as pivotal moments in the narrative of the development of contemporary art practice, the ephemeral is evident in both the aspect of time and that of the object necessary for the performance. Whilst everyday life is blurred with art in these works, so ordinary objects become tools or props within it, such as cloth, clothes, bicycles, pyjamas, or telephone. The aspect of time, the unexpected, is crucial for the avant-garde strategy of artists, whose implicit knowledge of the limits of the art establishment is central to the formal and temporal aspect of the work needed to fulfil its critical function. Okay, so I'm going to go on now to talk about two different performance artists. So Dwayne May, who is an artist currently based in Germany, who's been showing her performance on a daily basis at the Hayward Gallery this year, which has just finished in an exhibition called The Art of Change. And I'll read a little bit about her. Dwayne May has been using performance as her principal artistic medium for more than 15 years. She was born in Daqing, a city in northeast China. And since her participation in Beijing East Village in the 90s, her work has developed as a persistent inquiry into human experience as communicative, social, and embodied. Implicit in it is an emphatic recognition of the marginalized subject, which she herself plays out in work. Her girlish presence can be seen in various guises in her work, whether she is whispering intimately to a rabbit, hugging a computer on the pavement, or sitting in a blue dress in the middle of a field of hay, or lying face down naked under cardboard boxes on the top of a car, her legs flailing behind her. And this piece, Yimei in Wonderland, she often uses, one is the sense of the ephemeral in the work is very, very sort of overt, in the sense she uses a lot of objects which often get moved around during a durational performance of, say, several days or even weeks. And so she'll use things like beds, cots, cloth, found objects, rubbish, anything. But in this one, that's a fairly sort of typical language. And aesthetically strong and singular, her works nevertheless act as literary, yet quite pièce de résistance, contesting the conventional order of things as an exploration of human instincts, longings, and dark desires. Fran's work can be seen within the broader context of performance or live art as uniquely working within those of the transient, psychic, and subliminal key sites of art practice since the 1960s across Asia and the West. In her work, the body activates conversations about space, time, and the human psyche and social structures through a quiet yet powerful presence, playing with notions of silent forms of communication through physical and mental states of being. The nexus between articulation, communication, and creativity is brought to bear as verbal and textual communication is subordinated to the visual and physical aspects that characterize the world. And essentially, I'll just briefly tell you what kind of lies behind her position as an artist, which is that as a child, she was unable to speak clearly due to being born with a cleft palate, a disability that left its mark, not just physically, but psychologically, due to the stigma of this perceived abnormality at school and among her peers. And after days of fever following operation as a young adult, she experienced a kind of epiphany when certain dreams and psychic articulations became central to her decision to become an artist. So there's this constant sense of one, her marginalization, but also the need to communicate in an alternative way. Dwan's part in the iconic group performance work to add 1 meter to an anonymous mountain is an important starting point for which to understand her work. We which again goes back to another moment in the sort of post-89 development of contemporary Chinese art, when performance, and especially the body, became very prominent in artworks, mainly from Beijing, by the East Village community, who experimented sort of extensively with performance, but this was the first time it was much more consciously performance within an art context, not like previous. So performance as a medium in art practice in the 90s can be seen as a radical intervention within the realms of an emergent art world. After 89, a self-conscious synchronous relationship between the photographic image and the performance already told the move towards spectatorship that had not existed in the 1980s. So that along with essential aspects of participation, which you can see here, so there are some 10 artists in one world. There is also the sense of creating an image, you know, specifically an image of contemporary art for the first time. And this performance was carried out on a mountain outside Beijing with the naked bodies of 10 artists piled in a fleshy mound, adding to the mountain's surface of bodies and nature were fused together. The bodies are as anonymous and natural as the mountain itself, as they lie outside social and gender contexts. And it's, you know, beyond that moment, performance became a self-conscious synchronous relationship between the photographic image with the performance. And therefore there's already a sense of new works after life. I'll just tell you about Happy Yimei. So Happy Yimei, which has been her work in the Hayward Gallery in the last few months. In this work, she plays the protagonist in an imagined story or dream. Her performance installations consist of environments where she carries out extensive processes of experimentation. And in this whimsical performance, the visitor is made to crouch down to enter a dimly lit room filled with wispy trees, as though stepping into the scene of a fairy tale. Joanne comes out of the trees, humming in a strange communication, again, it's very strong and warm. And the messages, which could be anything about, sort of, do you know anything about Tanganistic poetry, or go out and find somebody, you know, in nearby, and ask them if they love their mother, anything. Of anything, often about sort of something either quite domestic or some personal, or it might be about China or something in the news. So it's kind of random what she writes, but not totally random, but it's about connecting herself to the outside world through the visitor, through the encounter. So the mute messages lend an intimacy to the experience, connecting each individual visitor to the artist, who acts as an agent between the interior and the exterior. The exhibition seen as a space bound by the ideologies of art and its institution and the outside world. Joanne's work is like a whisper, igniting conversations and further encounters in a gentle ripple of personal contact. The apparent childishness of her work belies a deep intelligence and sensitivity towards the dynamics of politics, exhibition practices, and their absurd boundaries and snobberies. So running through her work is this thing about between consciousness and subconsciousness. And so she sort of taps on something very intuitive in human psyche. Okay, so I'm going to move on to another performance, which relates to ephemera in a different way. I'm going to skip that one out. I'll just very quickly. So these performances are by a duo based in the UK called Mad for Real. And one of the themes I wanted to go into, which I haven't got time for, is this sense of the memorialising, and again this issue of death that comes in. Stephanie mentioned some of the things that cross over, and it's about the way that the ephemeral in artwork can act to memorialise realize and sustain memory of something which is past. And it's the, you know, the action that's important, the commemoration that's important for peace. And this was one of the ones was about the tonkal pickers who drowned in Morecambe Bay, who'd come from China, and they'd come to the UK to work for a snakehead gang as neighbours. And then they subsequently drowned in a terrible accident by being swept under by the quicksand in the bay. And this work, the artist sort of wrote the words "Quadrant," like living, on the sand, and then the sea swept away the words. So again, it's got this sense of memorial thing. And in this one is again a memorial work in which they commemorate the 58 Chinese immigrants who were again found dead in a lorry arriving in the UK, having been transported from Fujian province across the world to build a new life. And this work was about this. But it was a kind of work where people were invited into the van to have tomato juice. It was a kind of interactive work in which they stayed in a sort of small lorry themselves over 3 days and held a kind of conversation with people about this event. I quickly want to move on to Wasteland, which is Song Dong's monumental performance, which was also shown in London this year, which involved, it's a huge project, which was about essentially, it was showing 10,000 household objects which were collected by his own mother over 5 decades, including all sorts of household items such as bottle tops, bottles, clothes, cloth, furniture, toys, endless objects. And it's about his mother's obsessive collecting of these everyday items. And it became a sort of form of mourning for her, loss of her husband. At which point the mother, who's called Zhao Xiangyan, began collecting even more sort of extreme degrees. So it ended up with the house being so full of objects, they had to, basically, Song Dong felt that they had to do something about it. And he made this exhibition with his mother involved in actually arranging the objects in space and being in the gallery. This was in Beijing in 2005, the original installation. This was shown at Barbican Art Gallery this year, I think it was February to June this year. And it involves ephemera, very well, obviously, with the whole thing. It's this huge sort of, it's a vast collection, but the actual arranging of the object is very sort of carefully carried out. And subsequent to the first exhibition in Beijing, which was at the Tokyo Gallery, his mother died 3 years ago. And so each time the exhibition is reinstalled, the whole family comes together to install the items themselves. So it's a kind of, again, this sense of the sort of memory of the person through the objects and the kind of respect that's paid on each iteration. I just thought I'd put in that as well. It's just a classic song there now. And then I'm going to finish, but I'll just take you through one or two more. So this is Chen Zhen's Purification, which also is done posthumously to the artist's death. He died in 2001. But this is also carried out with his widow. His widow does the installation. And it's an installation of objects which are gathered at the time of the exhibition, around the exhibition gallery, wherever it is. This was Hayward Gallery again, in the Art of Change. So the objects are found locally, and his widow then arranged the objects, and then they're covered in a layer of thin mud, which kind of gives it a sense of purification and imbues it with a sort of poetics in space, and again has that sense of spirituality within it. And then the Anshauji worked with silkworms, and there are two more that I wanted to show you, but I'm going to stop. I can just very quickly play you the Iwayways in the end. So this last work is just a sound work of him memorializing each child who died in this earthquake.
Yeah.
相见, 流利, 林磊, 李健, 李路,
李亚,
林念,
李说,
刘关,
刘磊,
李荣,
李倩,
李勋,
李翔,
刘全.
So the idea here, which brings together the whole concept of it, is that the word Nian, which means remembrance, incorporates the word for heart and the word for present. And so it's about connecting into the present.